Good morning, Gateway. Welcome to Gateway Elim Church Online. And it's a pleasure to have you with us this morning. Just this week, I've been reading through Luke, and I want to read these verses to you this morning. This is from Luke chapter 4 and verse 18. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." And we know that Jesus stood up in the synagogue and said, "Today these words have been fulfilled." But I would encourage you, when you read these verses, put your name into them and read them. Let me read it and give you just an example. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, Marty Davison. He, because he has anointed me, Marty Davison, to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent Marty Davison to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." I want you to be encouraged and be excited this morning that God has called you. His Spirit is upon you. He has anointed you for a purpose this morning. May God bless you as we come and we worship together in our own homes. And just before we start and praise God, and we're going to start with a classic. I love it. "I stand amazed in the presence." And just before we start and sing that, let's just commit this time to God. God, we just want to thank you. God, we want to thank you for being able to worship you freely in this country. We want to thank you for your call upon our lives. God, infill us. God, open our spiritual eyes to see clearly your glory all around us, to see clearly what you're doing at this time. Father God, open our eyes that we might stand amazed and in awe of you. So God, we just say, fill us. Fill our living rooms. Come and fellowship with us as we come together online in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's sing together. "I stand amazed in the presence."
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean, singing how marvelous, how wonderful in my soul shall verse again. "I stand amazed. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner my His face I last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to see of His love for me. Everybody sing.
Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come.
Let your will.
let your glory fall in this room. Let it go forth from here to the nations. Let your fragrance rest in this place as we gather to seek your face. We are gathered to seek your
Come and have your way in me. Just let that be the cry of your heart, your positioning before God this morning and daily. And so we've got some announcements for you this morning. Devotions will continue. We're in the book of Luke. We continue into chapter 4 and 5. And I will be doing devotions online Monday to Saturday. Next slide, please. Thank you. And so we've got communion next week. So that's a heads up. Please have your wine, juice, and bread ready so that we can share communion together in our own homes. And also, the Gateway Kids continue to produce just excellent material, excellent stories for the kids. And I would encourage you, keep on tuning into that. Share it with people on Facebook. Up next, I announced last week, and let me just read again, the church holiday. We are aware that we are still holding people's deposits for this year. We have not done anything yet regarding refunds as we've been trying to obtain confirmation from the hotel about next year's holiday. But this is proving very difficult in the light of current circumstances. We have a provisional only booking for the 20th of May 2021 to the 31st of May 2021 at the same hotel. Depending on confirmation, deposits for next year would soon be due, and we assume most people would simply want to carry them forward. However, if you prefer any monies to be refunded, then please just let David or Denise know via the church office if you don't have their contact details. And so that is from David and Denise. Thank you very much, David and Denise, all the work you have been doing. And the last church holiday at the Penyard House Hotel was amazing. And I've already asked our speaker, who is meant to be with us this year, if he'll come next year, and he's going to come along still. So praise God for that. Next slide, please. Risk assessment and roadmap. We have basically completed our risk assessment and roadmap. We're tweaking it. Then it'll be sent off to Elim, and we will let you know as soon as that has been approved. Following on from that, we've got Zoom on Tuesday with myself, Pastor Marty. On Wednesday at 7 o'clock, there's Zoom with the Gateway Youth. And if you are a youth and in Gateway Elim Church, I would encourage you, join in. It'll be great fun. You will definitely enjoy it. Sometimes I stick my head into the Zoom meeting to see how things are going. Thursday, we're back with Word and Prayer, and we're just seeing some amazing answers to prayer, God's faithfulness. So join in with us. It's live stream on Thursday night at 7:30. And then once again, guys, thank you for your online giving. Thank you just for just your support through this time, for, you know, maintaining the work of the church and making it us able to just produce what we're producing online through your giving and support, and also keep up with paying the bills. Next week, I'm back again. We're here again, 10:30, so please tune in. And now, next slide, and this is the first slide. New garments are coming. New garments are coming is the title of this message. The title will make more sense as we go along. I hope you're going to be really blessed with this morning's message. I believe that God has put on my heart another word of encouragement for us. You know, can I have the next slide, please? Last week, we were looking at and talking about responding well. You know, how many have felt, you know, sadness, discouragement, weariness, and despondency during this time, and how at this time, if you pop on the next slide, it's, you know, how you respond to the situation you find yourself in is crucial. And, you know, just that God encouraging us to trust in Him, to respond in faith, to be aware that God continues to want to encourage and show that He is a miracle-working God. He is the great I Am. So keep on holding on to His promises. Can I have the next slide, please? Last week, I mentioned Genesis in 50 and verse 20, and it says this: "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." Let me read that out to you. "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." And this morning, I want us to have a look at Joseph's life. So let's open our Bibles in Genesis and chapter 37. Genesis and chapter 37. And I'm going to be reading from verse 3. And so what we're going to do is we're going to do like a whistle-stop tour of Joseph's life, as I believe God wants to use it to speak into our lives individually and collectively. And so if I can have the next slide there, please, Phil, just showing there's Joseph. And reading verse 3 to 8. Okay, and Joseph is 17 years old when we join the story. And it says, "Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was a son of his old age. Also, he made him a tunic of many colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Now Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more. So he said to them, 'Please hear this dream which I have dreamed. There we were, binding sheaves in the field. Then behold, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And indeed, your sheaves stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf.' And his brothers said to him, 'Shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us?' So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words." And so, you know, we are joining Joseph's story when Joseph was 17. But we read that Joseph was the son of his father's old age, and that Joseph's dad loved Joseph more than all his children, right from when he was born the whole way through. This just didn't start at age 17, but this tunic was the symbol of his father's favoritism. Can you imagine growing up in a house with such discrimination? So you can understand why his brothers hated him. He had privilege, he had protection, he had favor, he had favoritism, which they didn't have. And so we read on. Genesis in 37 and verse 20 says this: "Come, therefore, let us now kill him and cast him into some pit, and we shall say, 'Some wild beast has devoured him.' We shall see what will become of his dreams." But Reuben heard it, and he delivered him out of their hands and said, "Let's not kill him." And Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood, but cast him into this pit, which is in the wilderness, and do not lay a hand on him, that he might deliver him out of their hands and bring him back to his father." And so the brothers, this hate, it spills over, and they decide to plot against Joseph. They plot Joseph's downfall. Let's get rid of him. Let's just throw him in this pit. And let me read on. And in 39, you know, what they do is they throw him in a pit, and then they see these merchants going, and they sell him to these merchants. And so he ends up going off to Egypt. It says they sold him for 20 shekels of silver, and they took Joseph to Egypt. And so we continue on, chapter 39, and I'm reading 1-4. And so now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and served him. Then he made him overseer of his house and all that he had put under his authority. Reading on, verses 7 and 8 says this: And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast long eyes on Joseph, and she said, Lie with me. But he refused and said to his master's wife, Look, my master does not know what is with me in the house, and he has committed all that he has to my hand. And so Joseph has been sold into slavery. He ends up in Egypt, and then he is bought by Potiphar. Now, Potiphar, beyond being a wealthy man, is a man of position. He is captain of the Pharaoh's guard. And here, Joseph works under Potiphar, and he has favor in the sight of God and Potiphar. But Potiphar's wife takes a liking to Joseph, and then she cries, as we would say, blue murder. And Joseph ends up being falsely accused, and he goes from being a slave, a servant, to a criminal. And so he ends up in jail. And it says, Then Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were confined. And he was there in the prison. And so Joseph's got this favor, but it's all gone pear-shaped. Now we read on. And in verse 23, chapter 39, verse 23, it says this: The keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it to prosper. Once again, we see how in a grueling situation, Joseph walks in God's favor. And because he walks in God's favor, he has favor with man, and he has favor with the prison keeper. And many people will know the story that while Joseph is in prison in Genesis chapter 40, we will see that Pharaoh's baker and butler end up in jail. And they have dreams, and the person called to interpret their dreams is Joseph. And Joseph interprets their dreams correctly. And when he is interpreting their dreams, he says, Remember me. But when they got out, one lost his head and one was reinstated. The butler was reinstated, but he forgot what Joseph had done for him until there came an appointed time. And we see that appointed time in Genesis chapter 41 and verse 1. Then it came to pass at the end of 2 full years that Pharaoh had a dream. And behold, he stood by the river. And Pharaoh, you know, is looking for someone to interpret the dream. And the butler says, I know your man, Joseph. I met him in prison. And so he is called out of prison, and he is standing before Pharaoh. Now, as I said, it's been a whistle-stop tour, and we've gone from Joseph at 17 to now Joseph is 30 years old. 13 years have passed. You know, I love the story of Joseph. You know, life going from bad to worse. Joseph has favor with God and some men, but, you know, but there's always a but. And what is happening? God is preparing Joseph. God is preparing Joseph on so many levels. He's preparing him emotionally. He's preparing him mentally. He's preparing him psychologically. He's preparing him spiritually. God has been stripping Joseph, stripping him to clothe him in a way he could never have dreamed of. For God to clothe him, he had to strip him, stripping him of mindsets that his earthly father had put in. Some of the mindsets, that sense of being better than others, that sense of self-righteousness, that sense of privilege, where the value system isn't God's, there is a danger of pride and arrogance. God had to put Joseph through the mill. And 13 years later, Joseph is standing before Pharaoh. The man standing in front of Pharaoh had learnt a few things. Can I have the next slide, please? And that is just an image taken off the throne of one of the pharaohs. And you can see how ornate it is. And it gives you an idea of the wealth of the Egyptian society. It was. Joseph had to learn a few things. It was his dad in heaven who provided. It was his dad in heaven who protected. He learned to praise God, not in just the bad circumstances. He learned to praise God through the long valley of slavery and prison. It wasn't over in a day. It wasn't over in a week. It wasn't over in a month. 13 years later, he finds himself standing before Pharaoh. God had stripped away all that needed to be stripped away. Before rebuilding, before refitting, before putting on new garments, you must undergo the essential process of stripping. I've got a slide there. The essential process of stripping away before rebuilding. It reminds me a little of these extreme makeovers, you know? Have you seen them? Extreme makeovers of houses, even of cars. They even do it with people as well. And after stripping, then comes the restoration process. Work takes place, like that of an old car. And I've got a slide, and I think it's a fantastic slide. You can see how this car has been stripped back and then rebuilt, reclothed, new garments put on it, so to speak. It looks nothing like what it looked like before. Listen to me. It looks nothing like it looked like before. Hold that in your mind. Hold that in your heart. See, after the stripping away comes the preparation. You know, Joseph in slavery, in prison, was learning wonderful God-like traits. How to be humble. You know, being humble isn't being self-debased. You know, being humble is actually knowing who you are before God. You know, being humble is rooted in dependency on God, in trusting in God. You know, how to be meek. You know, being meek isn't being puny or weak. I remember when I was doing the study on the Beatitudes and looking into meekness, and I produced a slide which I want to show to you again. Maybe some of you will remember it. And it's praus. And let me read this slide to you. The Greek word praus was used to define a horse trained for battle. Wild stallions were brought down from the mountains and broken for riding. Some were used to pull wagons, some were raced, and the best were trained for warfare. They retained their fierce spirit, courage and power, but were disciplined to respond to the slightest nudge or pressure of the rider's leg. They could gallop into battle at 35 miles per hour and come to a sliding stop at a word. They were not frightened by arrows, spears, or torches. Then they were said to be meek. And wow, you get that vision of meekness where you surrender your whole life to God, and God uses all your qualities, endued with the power of the Holy Spirit, to bring about His will as He orders it. Meekness. You see that strength in the hands of God. Tremendous. You see, there's a key component in God's preparation. You know, in devotions, we've been studying the book of Luke, and John the Baptist, you know, was sent to prepare the way, sent to prepare the way for Jesus, for the Messiah, for the Christ. And his message was a message of repentance. Repent, turn back to God. Repent, turn back to God's ways. Repent, do God's will. And Jesus came, and his message, next slide please, Phil. Thank you, sir. Very subtle slide. Repent. And we can read in Matthew and 4. Let me go there. Matthew and 4. And verse 17 says this. And from that time, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Stop doing things your way. Turn and do them God's way. Repent. You know, what kept Joseph going those 13 years? What kept Joseph going when things, to the unobserved, kept getting worse? You see, Joseph understood the refining process of gold. Or maybe better said, Joseph understood the refining process of God, which is like the refining process of gold. The removal of impurities. You heat up the gold and the impurities rise to the top and they are cleaned away. Why put the time and the effort in to removing the impurities from the gold? Because you are preparing it for something great. You are preparing it for something glorious. You are preparing it to be on display and seen by all. Can I have the next slide, please? And so we've got there the gold in the crucible being heated up time and time again, removing the impurities. And the refiner knows when the gold is ready because it reflects his image. Hallelujah. Gold is being refined for a purpose. Gold is being readied, prepared for something glorious. You see, God had a great responsibility for Joseph. God was preparing Joseph to succeed. God was making sure that Joseph could be entrusted with the weight of the responsibility that he was going to have to carry. All the eyes of the world were going to be on Joseph. You see, just as God has a plan for Joseph, and just as God had a plan for Joseph, God has a plan for the church, for many souls to be saved through the church. Amen. God is saying, in the last days, the love of many will grow cold. Can I have the next slide, please, Phil? And it says, because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. In the last days, the love of many will grow cold. God must strip away wrong mindsets. God must expose all the impurities, all the selfishness, all the self-righteousness, the discrimination, the favoritism. God must strip it away during this time, away, so that we can be the church that God has called us to be, so that we can reflect the image of God, so that we can be reclothed as God wishes to reclothe us. Will you keep the faith during the process? Will you keep a good attitude as you go through the long process? Will you repent and turn to God as He shows you time and time and time again the things that you have picked up from your earthly fathers, from the people around you that He wants to address and remove? You see, if we look at what John the Baptist says about Jesus in Luke chapter 3, let's go there. Luke chapter 3. Praise you, God. Luke chapter 3 and verse 16, it says this: John answered, saying to all, "I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." Amen. Now look at this. "His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather the wheat into his barn, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." God is preparing his church. Jesus is separating the wheat from the chaff. He's removing all the rubbish. Why? Because God wants to put new garments on his church. God wants to show, God wants to reveal his glory to the world at this time through his church, not some counterfeit attempt. Can I have the next slide, please? And you can see there, it says a verse from Isaiah 40. Let me go there. Isaiah 40 and verse 5. Says this: "The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." God wants to reveal his glory in all the church, not just the church in Africa, not just the church in Latin America, but in all of his church, all the church throughout the globe. You know, let's rejoin now the story of Joseph. And Joseph has heard Pharaoh's dream. Joseph has interpreted it and interpreted it well. And we read in Genesis 41 and verse 37 what happens next. Let's go there. Let's see what's happening. So we know that Joseph was sold into slavery. We know that Joseph spent 13 years as a slave, as a servant, as a prisoner. And then, after all this stripping away and process of rebuilding and developing, he is now before Pharaoh. Genesis 41 and verse 37 says this: "So the advice was good in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of all his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, 'Can we find such a one as this, a man in whom is the Spirit of God?' Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, 'Inasmuch as God has shown you all this, there is no one as discerning and wise as you. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you.' And Pharaoh said to Joseph, 'See, I have set you over all the land of Egypt.' Then Pharaoh took his signet ring off his hand, put it on Joseph's hand, and he clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. And he had him ride in the second chariot which he had, and they cried out before him, "Bow the knee." So he set him over all the land of Egypt. Pharaoh also said to Joseph, "I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no man may lift his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt." Wow. We see Joseph has been reclothed in glory, reclothed in responsibility, reclothed in authority. God's man seen by all. Joseph. God in Joseph seen by all. Can I have the next slide, please? And there we see Joseph dressed in Egyptian garments. And it says, "Therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time." As we end, we return to the verse that we started with in Genesis 50 and verse 20. Let's read it again. Next slide, please, Phil. "But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring it about as it is this day, to save many people alive." Hear Joseph's words. Hear Joseph's heart. This is a man who has gone through the process, has been stripped by God, rebuilt by God, reclothed by God, and he sees things no longer from his natural sight. When Joseph spoke the dreams of his brothers bowing down before him, Joseph was dressed as a 17-year-old, full of pride and arrogance because what had been put into him from his father. But now Joseph speaks with the perspective, with the vision of God. Joseph has gone from having the sight of a boy dreamer to a man with God's perspective. Church, listen. God has stripped the church back. God is preparing the church for his purpose, that many souls might be saved. Amen. Many souls. Get God's perspective on this time. Let him clothe you, that you will not look like the way you looked like before. Can you see that? Last slide, please, Phil. Let God clothe you. May that be your heart this morning. May that be the cry of your heart. God, do what you need to do in me. Just as we close, I want us to sing this song, "Here I Am Waiting. Abide in me, I pray." Church, God wants to reclothe us with new garments so that we do not look like we have looked like before. Joseph could never have imagined being dressed in the garb of Egyptian royalty. Could never have imagined. We can't imagine how God wants to change and transform and reclothe his church to reveal his glory at this time. Prepare your hearts. Amen. Let's sing, "Abide with me, I pray."